As I'm sure many of you are aware, most of the world is dealing with an ongoing obesity epidemic. Obesity prevalence has been steadily rising over the past four decades, and there appears to be no end in sight. Current estimates suggest that by the year 2030, nearly one in two U.S. adults will be obese. Many people know that obesity is a risk factor for the development of various metabolic diseases such as type 2 diabetes. However, many people don't know that mothers who are obese give birth to offspring who are predisposed to developing metabolic diseases later in life. These intergenerational effects of maternal obesity are an area of heavy research as the mechanisms of these programming effects are yet to be discovered. Recently, the McCurdy Lab conducted an experiment in non-human primate model, which analyzed the effects of maternal obesity and maternal diet on the gene expression of offspring skeletal muscle. Surprisingly, maternal exposure to a Western-style diet high in fat and sugar compared to a standard control diet resulted in the dysregulation of over 3,000 genes in the skeletal muscle of offspring. Carrying the results of this experiment further, the purpose of this project was to assess whether these alterations in the gene expression resulted in alterations in cellular function. Many of the genes found to be dysregulated are associated with the cellular quality control pathways of autophagy and mitophagy. Autophagy is the process of recycling intracellular components as a way of ensuring cellular quality control. Mitophagy specifically refers to the autophagic clearance of mitochondria. To assess functional consequences of these alterations in gene expression, we developed two flow cytometry-based assays to look at the relative abundance of damaged mitochondria, as well as the ability for cells to regulate lysosome biogenesis, which is a key process mediated by autophagic flux. I'll point your attention to figure 1A and 1B, which shows the sensitivity of our mitochondria assay to pick up differences in the relative abundance of damaged mitochondria. The y-axis of figure 1A is showing the fluorescence intensity of mitospite DILC15 staining, which stains for healthy mitochondria with their membrane potential intact. The x-axis is showing fluorescence intensity of mitospite green staining, which is a general mitochondrial stain, so it gives a measure of total mitochondrial volume. Figure 1B illustrates the ratio between mitospite DILC15 to mitospite green staining in response to varying degrees of CCCP treatment, which is a chemical that damages mitochondria. As you can see, there's a clear trend in which increasing CCCP concentration results in a reduction in the total number of healthy mitochondria normalized to the total number of mitochondria. I'll now point your attention to the figure 1C and 1D, which shows the sensitivity of our lysosome biogenesis assay to pick up differences in lysosome abundance. This assay makes use of a stain called acridine orange, which is rather unique in that it has two emission spectra. When it accumulates in lysosome, it fluoresces red. However, everywhere else in the cell, it fluoresces green. Figure 1C, the y-axis is showing red acridine orange fluorescence intensity, whereas the x-axis is showing green acridine orange fluorescence intensity. Instead of CCCP treatment, this assay uses rapamycin, as it has been shown to induce lysosome biogenesis. Figure 1D illustrates the ratio between acridine orange red to green mean fluorescence intensity, and as you can see, there's a strong increase in this ratio with increasing rapamycin concentration. The experiments I just described were performed in immortalized L6 rat myoblasts rather than non-human primate myoblasts, as the non-human primate cells are too valuable to be used for assay optimization. From the concentration series we performed in the L6 cells, we selected a CCCP concentration of 10 micromolar and a rapamycin concentration of 0.5 micromolar to treat non-human primate cells, as these fell within the linear range of our assay. Figure 2 shows the results of the assays being run with isolated myoblasts from a single non-human primate subject ran in triplicate with the concentrations I just mentioned. Figure 2A depicts the results of the mitophagy assay. It should be noted that palmitate was also added as a physiologically relevant cellular stressor, as any programming effects might take added stress to be noticed. As expected, the addition of just CCCP resulted in a reduced ratio of DILC15 to green. However, interestingly, palmitate treatment saw very little differences in the ratio compared to the group control group, even with CCCP treatment. Figure 2B depicts the ratio of the lysosome, or depicts the results of the lysosome assay. Also, as expected, addition of just rapamycin resulted in an increased ratio of red to green. Palmitate treatment resulted in a similar increase as rapamycin treatment, and the two together saw a drastic increase, which illustrates an additive effect. Unfortunately, due to timing constraints, we were only able to run this assay in a single non-human primate subject, and thus we can't say whether or not there are differences based on maternal diet exposure with the data presented here. However, the assays appear to be working great, and we are working towards performing these experiments with adequate sample size and across maternal diet groups. This will allow us to test the hypothesis of whether exposure to maternal Western-style diet impairs the cellular quality control mechanisms of autophagy and mitophagy. Thank you very much.